friends, and welcome to the program Eye to Eye. This brings to you a glimpse of the person behind the legends and the surgeons that we have all known for so many years. Ladies and gentlemen, the world of ophthalmology is in total awe of him for almost 5 decades. An epitome of success, the father of Indian ophthalmology, a lovable human being, ever so kind, ever so helpful, iconic and evergreen. The King of Mumbai, we have the proud privilege of having with us today, Padma Shri Professor Dr. K.K. Mehta, sir.
Thank you for having me.
A very warm welcome to you, sir, and thank you so much for accepting my invitation to be on this program, Eye to Eye.
Thank you.
Dr. K.K. Mehta, sir, doesn't need any introduction. Nevertheless, for the benefit of our viewers, I'd like to present a brief video about his professional accomplishments. Professor K.K. Mehta is a living legend, a pioneer in cataract and refractive surgery, a brilliant surgeon with outstanding surgical skills and innovative surgical techniques with a vast experience. He is also Professor Emeritus at Breach Candy Hospital and D.Y. Patil Medical College and Hospital. He graduated from Christian Medical College, Ludhiana, Diploma from Amritsar Medical College and post-graduation from PGI Chandigarh. He joined the prestigious Moorfields Eye Hospital, London and completed his DO with top honours. Studied in Dublin, UK and passed the DO Dublin and joined Municipal Eye Hospital in Mumbai in 1971. He pioneered the first soft HEMA IOL in the world in 1978, which was also published. He is a pioneer in radial keratotomy in India and started phacoemulsification as early as 1989. They also have a charitable project called as the Netra Rakshak Rural Eye Hospital. He has attended numerous workshops and has been invited to so many international conferences. He is also the chairman and chief organizing secretary of the highly successful and popular Eye Advance Congress for the past 25 years. A little about the awards that he has won over so many years. He has won many outstanding Indian awards and gold medals, and also a lot of international ones like the LIM International Award, the award at the ESCRS at Vienna in 2018, the Triple Ribbon Award of the American Intraocular Implant Society. He was also one of the few Indian surgeons to have operated live at Europe's biggest live surgery conference in 2008 at Milan, Italy. The Asia Pacific Award at Seoul, Korea in 2000. The Antonio Scarpa Medal Award again in Italy in 2012. The Swiss Eye Foundation International Award in 2018. The ASCRS Award at Boston, USA in 2015, which is considered as their highest award. He was also felicitated by the Hungarian Cataract and Refractive Surgery Society and the Polish Ophthalmological Society. And finally, the icing on the cake was he was awarded the Padma Shri by the President of India in 2002. Wow, sir, that's an amazingly impressive CV. Totally impressed. Sir, you've been a star across continents, but every mighty oak begins as a small acorn. Sir, how were you as a schoolboy and as a young college student?
Well, I was okay, nothing very great. I certainly didn't shine as much as one would expect. Though I did well in school, I did okay in college. I stood first in Punjab University when I did my MBBS.
Wow.
I mean, I think I started picking up, you know, after I joined medical college. First 3-4 years of medical college was just fun. After that, I started getting a little serious. But then after that, it's fine. I joined, I did my DO in Ludhiana, and then did my for subsequent work a little in Amritsar, same time as Daljit Singh was there. And subsequently, I did my MS from PGI Chandigarh. And then after that, of course, I went abroad. But it was good fun. I mean, I did a lot of things which perhaps I never would have done there with all the boys there at church. The times I spent at Christian Medical College in Ludhiana was absolutely great. I had some great friends, and we used to have get into a lot of trouble, but it was good.
So you were like a naughty boy?
Well, I never really, you know, fitted into the, as one would say, the groove which everybody said you should go in for. I did what I wanted to do. And unfortunately, it always did tend to get me in trouble once in a while.
Actually, that was the next thing I had to ask you was, like, when you see nature versus nurture, they say just 3-5% of people in the world actually know what they want to do in life. And almost 95% of the world discover as they go on what they want to do. So how was it with you, sir? Did you always want to be an ophthalmologist?
No, my Dr. Rustam Ranji from Hyderabad was a well-known eye surgeon. And he was a World War II veteran. He had only a single eye. He used to operate and do everything with that eye. He was the one who really got me going into it. So from that stage onwards, yes, I always wanted to be an ophthalmologist.
So he was like your role model?
Well, yes and no. He was like the model which I thought would be great.
Okay. So, and how were your steps after that? Did you have any plans for the future? How did you go about fulfilling your career?
Not really. You know, in when I was in Christian Medical College in Ludhiana, my professor was a professor by the name of Simon Franken. He was a great guy, and he's from Holland and a Dutchman. And the interesting thing was, he was perhaps the first retina surgeon who was there in Ludhiana. So the first surgeries which I did were all retina. We used to do banding using the technique which was established by Weiwei, which is a very old method of banding and which was put there. And we used to drain fluid from the eye, and that's how we did it. We were also the first in the country to get the solar, what they call as helioscope, for applying laser in the retina. So as I said, I had a pretty good grounding for retina. So my whole idea was that this would be a way to go. However, when I finally decided to go abroad to London at the Moorfield Eye Hospital, I joined essentially as a cataract surgeon, which is how it started. But the story didn't end there. I spent a little time. I went there, and by that time, Franken, my professor, wrote to them saying that he's very skilled in the retina. So they said, why don't you go on to the retina side? And I joined the retina section. And after a period of 5 months, the one of the top surgeons in the world, who was an intraocular implant surgeon, his wife expired. So subsequently, that was Binghorst. And Binghorst was a little depressed, and Binghorst and Franken were close friends. So I spent time with Binghorst at his place in the north. And Binghorst had this habit of going out on Saturday, Sunday on his boat. And in Grottingen, where he was, when he went on the boat, it was icy water, and they tied you to the mast so you didn't fly off. And at the end of 4 hours of getting totally soaked, he would look at you and say, wasn't it enjoyable? And of course, as a student, you said, yes, it was. But that beside the point. So as the time came, I was with him for almost a month, a little more than a month, 5 weeks. I said, now I'll go back to Moorfields, where I had joined. I was originally in Peter Fison's unit. And he tells me that, no, I think you are wasted in the retina. You will now go to the anterior unit. So I told him, I said, sir, I've joined on one side. I can't change. Yeah. He said, no, I've changed it for you. At that time, Peter Binghorst was one of the professor emeritus at Moorfield, so presumably what he said went. So when I came back, I joined the unit under Redmond Smith. You know Redmond Smith, he was the guy who used to pass a little plastic wire into the Schlems Canal in those days.
Oh my.
It was in 1971. You know, the aajkal baat ho rahi, you know, you
different
things. And Peter Scott was there, and that's how I joined the cataract side. So there I did my DO Ireland and I did the DO London there. And after that, they were asking me if I would like to stick over there, but unfortunately, I wanted to come back, so we decided to come back. But in between, before I could come back, he turned around and told me, he says, "Okay, before you go back, I want you to go to America and spend a little time there with Miles Galen." Miles Galen was one of the four or five surgeons in America who was doing intraocular implant surgery. So I shifted to New York and I spent time with Miles Galen doing, and Miles Galen had three other friends. One was Norman Jaffe, you know, the cataract guy, and Dennis Shepard, who has so often come to India, and Henry Hirschberg. And these four were called as the four horsemen of apocalypse, because they said, "You guys are going to destroy everything." So I joined them and I spent about 6-8 months there. And then after that, having spent a little time in California, a little time in New York, I came back. Well, I was happy to come back, because one big problem with Miles Galen was that at his hospital, you could only drink milk. He says, "If you drink anything else, your hand will shake. You're not allowed to do that." So he literally drank milk morning, afternoon, evening. And by that time, he got so fed up of milk that now you look in milk and you say, "Nine, nine, not worth it." So I came back and I started my practice here in Bombay.
Mumbai, yeah.
And, you know, after a period of about 3 months, the Municipal Eye Hospital, Kamatipura, opened up. So I joined Kamatipura, where everybody looked at me and said, "You done from London and all, you are joining Kamatipura." I said, "Yes, yes, a nice hospital." Mega jaha mile te sahi yaar, you cannot, you know, beggars can't be choosers. And, with me was Dr. Sathe, God's good man, and Dr. Kariyakar, both of whom are no longer there. So I joined their unit, and we first started doing intraocular implants in 1972 in Mumbai at Kamatipura.
We were just born at that time, sir.
And we presented the first four cases to the doctor at a meeting there. And it turned out pretty well, and we started doing a little more and more cases. And those cases were given, those implants were given to me by Miles Galen before I left New York. You know, in those days, we sterilized implants by putting them in a small plastic DB, Kodak at the peak, with one tablet of formalin. We just kept it there. When you took it out, you washed it thoroughly and put it in. We never got an infection. Sometimes I think whether those old-fashioned methods really worked as much as they said they were. Either way, we started doing well, and
there was no looking back, I think.
After that, the fun and game started. Life wasn't that easy, you know.
Sir, before you continue, there's a surprise for you. Sure. And I would like you to listen to this. Just a minute.
Hi, good evening. I'm Dr. Ranjit Mania. I'm here to tell you something about my mentor and my guide, Dr. K.K. Mehta, friend, philosopher, and guide, K.K. Mehta. We first met way back in 1979 at the first MOS conference at Hotel Mandovi, Goa. I was a resident and I had taken my first hesitant steps on stage by delivering a paper. Actually, for the first time in my life, I went on stage to deliver a paper, to read a paper. And before me, Dr. K.K. Mehta spoke before me on contact lenses. He actually took a mic, came down the aisle, became part of the audience and started addressing everybody from within the audience. And I said to myself, "Wow, that's where I want to be, that's where I want to go, that's what I want to achieve." I think I have reached there partially, if not completely, because K.K. is a difficult act to follow in a conference. But that's not the issue. The point I was making is, after my talk, naturally you want to release all your tension, your nervousness. And I was in the loop, and guess who walks in? Kiki. And he says, "Hey man, lovely talk, huh? Keep it up." That was Kiki, 79, young resident, black beard, not white, black beard, and he's encouraging me there even then without knowing who I was. It's not for nothing that he's called the Badshah of life surgery. He has no fear of the outcome, he's supremely confident, he knows what he's going to teach you, and therefore he's absolutely effective. Whether it was at BOA, Chitrakoot, with Lucio Burato, it makes no difference to his level of confidence. I'll give you an example. We were in Calcutta. I was in the OT with him, and he was demonstrating a water jet handpiece for phaco. Instead of phaco, instead of ultrasound, this was a water jet used to remove and suck out the nucleus. And Keki went on and on and on and on doing the operation, and it took him all of 10 minutes to do it, which is something unusual. At the end of it, I asked him, "Sir, what happened?" He said, "Sir, the handpiece nahi chaliyo, but I couldn't let on, I couldn't complain, I couldn't tell people, but the damn thing didn't work." So that's Keki, that's his magnanimity. The handpiece didn't work, but he didn't let on. He continued the surgery by just grazing the soft nucleus and just aspirating it out, but he didn't let on, and he didn't even tell the audience that the handpiece doesn't work. That's Keki for you. Speaking of high advance, you know, we were at the Taj from 96, 98, 2000, and in 2002 we shifted to the Grand Hyatt. Not because the rates were great, not because there was more place, but because there was free Wi-Fi for the delegates. Remember, this was 2002 and we were looking at free Wi-Fi for our delegates. That is Keki Mehta, always a few steps ahead of the rest of the pack.
Absolutely, sir. Isn't that amazing?
Yeah, even
very well said, Badshah of life surgery.
Thank you, Ranjit. Good words. Thank you.
Very, very sweet of him. So, but I'm sure this success wasn't easy. You were saying something on that. So you must have faced so many difficulties. What was the toughest part of your career?
No, I started doing implants in private practice, as one would say, on my own patients by about 74, 75. And I still remember one of our very senior surgeons in Bombay, saw one of my patients. A patient was good. I was 6'6 almost. And he looked at that patient and said, "Abhi, Sufed lakdi se chalna shuru karo, because you're going to be blind." And I remember that patient coming and saying, "What have you done? I'm going to go blind." I said, "No, nothing like that." But people didn't like the idea of implants. And as a matter of fact, they all thought they were very horrible. And it took a little time for it to pick up. Then we had a very interesting situation where a group of surgeons who had come and visited me from, if I remember right, from Calcutta. And they had been told that he doesn't really do anything, only talks about it. So they came and spent 4 or 5 days with me, and we had a great time together. They became great friends after that. As a matter of fact, I had operated at one of their places in Calcutta afterwards. But you know, people just didn't believe that implants really work the way they should.
You were the naysayers and you were the pioneer at that time. Right.
I was the fellow who put my foot in where nobody else was willing to do it, put it that way.
That requires a lot of guts.
Then in 77, I developed the world's first soft implant, a HEMA implant.
Yes.
By none other than Panthaki of Feroz Dastur and Company.
Oh, yes.
I presented that paper in 1978 and subsequently published in the Journal of the American Intraocular Implant Society. But that was the world's first soft implant, which was there. And there was a very interesting story. We were recording it. And those days, of course, there was no recording in microscopes, anything like that. So we had the photographer standing on top with the camera recording it. And after some time, the photographer just got off the stool and sat down because he felt giddy. And I asked him, "What happened?" He says, "Hab chakkar aa gaya." Which is one of the problems which used to happen in those days. You record it, you never show what you are going to get. But it used to go on and it used to get on well. Those days, you know, unlike nowadays, we are very scrupulously clean. We remove every bit of cortex, you know, chamak ni chahiye.
Yeah.
Days, it was advisable to leave cortex behind because that induced a certain amount of reaction which led the lens to be properly bonded on. Those days, we were using iris clip lenses. And those days, the fear of lens had just come.
Right.
Then in 70, what should I say, in 76, 77, just before, I had been to see Fedorov. Met him there, brought some of his lenses. It was working out fine. Then life gradually went on and implants started becoming a little more mainstream and more people started joining me. One of our earliest in Bombay to join me doing implant was none other than Ashok Shroff. We were all great friends in those days, and we used to go operating all over the whole of India, one place to another. I must have operated in virtually every city going. Interesting, you know, and every place you have interesting stories to tell. I still remember in Trichy when I was operating, it was a table which had a hoist, you know, it was like that. And here I was about to do it and remove the lens and put in the lens inside. Those days FECO hadn't started. I was using a forceps to remove the lens, intracapsular. And the one moment I held the lens, the next moment the table tilted when everybody wanted to come and have a look. And I was with the lens in my hand 1 second later. I frankly think that was the fastest delivery I've ever done. But it was good fun. It went off pretty well. Then of course, as time went along, changes happened. I started doing, I also took up, in addition to doing implants, I started doing radial keratotomy.
Right.
Radial keratotomy was no better introduction than anything else. Those days, there was a very nice symposium known as the Ahmedabad Academy of Ophthalmology, which we all used to attend. Thousands of people in a hall. And, you know, it was really nice, conducted by Dr. Nagpal and Babishi. And I still remember sitting on the stage, and with me was another very senior surgeon from Bombay. I'm not going to mention his name. And he looks at the audience and says, "Is there anybody in this audience who cuts into normal cornea?" The guy that was me at the back who sneakily put my hand up. Like a cockroach walking on a white floor. You know, he did such horrible things. But that was the day of the radial keratotomy. I wrote a textbook on it, which I one of the earliest books on RK in the world. And then after that, of course, changes occurred, and extracapsular cataract surgeries took over, and we started putting in lenses. I was probably also the earliest to put in the star pattern lenses, what we call as plate haptics, which are now quite common with Zeiss, etc. They were very uncommon. Yeah. So it was a lot of interesting things happened. And after that, I started to take up FECO emulsification. I had always had a feeling that you need to do it some way or the other, and
yeah, right.
To be done. So I went and spent time with Bob Meloni in USA and
right.
Did there. And I thought it was great, and I came back, but I didn't buy any machine. Then a little story to go with it. It was, we had a meeting in Bombay Hospital, and there was a guy who had come from Opticon, who had the same Opticon people who were, and they were demonstrating their FECO emulsifier. In those days, they demonstrated it in a glass of water, saying, "See, you can see the water shaking there." That was all that it was. And this was the last day of the show. And he was there, and it was held in Bombay Hospital, just opposite Western Hotel, if you know.
Right.
So I was there, and I was sitting, I was getting a little bored also, so I was pulling his leg. I said, "Yeah, why are you taking this machine back? Leave it with me now, na."
Okay.
And, he was at the end of his trip, which he had done all over, and he had not been able to sell the machine. So he says, ultimately got a little fed up of me, I think. His name was Agnucci, who was then the head of Opticon. And he said, "Okay, I'll sell you the machine. But this is the amount which I want, but I want you to pay me now." So now I was caught. I didn't want to buy the machine. So I turned around and said, "You see, it uses tips. We don't have enough tips. Where will I get them from?" He said, "I'll give you, give me 150 tips.
And oh, my.
They were, you know, like you have the machine gun sachets in a line.
Yes.
put the whole thing out and said, see, this whole line of things are there, now you take this machine. So in the evening, I took the machine with all the things, and I remember going to my house, and I put it in the middle of the hall. That box had traveled all over the world, so it was all looking totally locked out. And it was a machine which was printed, it was painted gray, and a gray okay ka dabba. And you put it in the hall, and my wife looks at me and says, what have you bought? So I said, I bought this machine. So we have finally paid him, and he left. As he was going, I asked him, I said, manual? He said, what manual? You plug this here, and you plug this here, and you turn it on, then it works. That was finally. Nothing more, nothing less. So those were the early days of FACO.
Absolutely, that's really nice. I mean, you sir, must have seen so many changes in technology, like over the span of 5 decades, with a successful practice. So which do you think was the most revolutionary change in technology?
I think FACO really made a difference.
FACO, yes.
And though it made me very unpopular in the beginning, I still remember when at our All India conference, when people come and ask me that you are doing FACO, it can only be done in urban cities. And I turned around and told them, I said, FACO is required in rural places where a man must recover his vision and walk. And they all thought I was a little crazy to say it. But it will become, you know, FACO will become mainstream, I mean.
Right. So, apart from technology, there's also a great change in the kind of practice that we have done. So, sir, if you consider practice, according to you, what positive and negative changes have you found in the way practice has evolved over so many years and your relationship with patients?
I don't know. I think we don't talk as much to patients as we used to. Those days, you know, on my form, I had the name of the person, I had his children's names, I had his wife's name. I had something interesting to talk about the patient. When he came the next day, I would tell him, you are so-and-so, yes, how are you? How is your business getting on? You know, you are personal friends with the patient. Askal, you know, once your practice increases beyond a certain amount, you really can't spend time. And that is something which I always regretted when the practice built up.
Yeah.
I still remember in the early days, I used to be probably the earliest surgeon operating, and I used to finish seeing my last patient at 12:30 at night. That was I used to say good morning to the patients, and they used to carry a little dibba, and they used to eat food sitting outside. And it was good fun. I mean, you know, you got to know your patients, they got to know you. You know, we were friends. Relationship is breaking down a little nowadays. I think we really need to.
We don't have the time to talk to the patients. And probably that is crumbling that relationship.
You know, as you grow older, you learn a lot. My father was a banker, a very illustrious banker. He retired as Deputy General Manager of Bank of India. An extraordinary person who taught me a lot. And I still remember him telling me that he had gone those days, there were a few top surgeons. One of them was Dr. Banaji, who was the senior Banaji.
Right.
My father used to consult him for his eyes. And he used to tell me that, he is a marvelous person. Do you know, he always puts his hand on my shoulder and leads me to the door after he finishes the consultation. And I was tempted to turn around and say, it's because you talk so much, you're pushing me to the door. You know, the fact remains that he remembered their hand on the shoulder, you know. And then if you say the words, as one would say of Jesus Christ, lay your hands. That means, you know, there's a personal contact with the patient.
Right.
What we now do is as a bad case, you know, where they that is not the way to do it.
Absolutely. I remember you mentioning this in one of the conferences, sir, that you need to touch your patient, just put your hand on his shoulder and tell him that you're doing well. And, you know, that really makes so much difference.
Makes a world of difference.
Right. So you mentioned about working till late in the night. I would like you to listen to this. Just a moment.
Hi everyone, I'm Cyrus Mehta. And thanks very much, Anaga, for interviewing Dad. He is truly one of the living legends of ophthalmology. Nowadays, we find that every third, fourth person, they say living legend and give them an award. But this title befits him more than anyone else. Well, growing up in the Mehta household was a unique experience. The clinic would start from 2 o'clock in the afternoon, and it was part of our house, and it would run till 12 midnight, and about he would see about 200 people by himself and take measurements by himself and do everything himself. So the clinic would run to 12 midnight, and then we would eat dinner at 12:30. So I see all the kids sleeping at 9 o'clock, and I'm laughing like we never went to sleep before 12:30. Dad was a pioneer in intraocular implants and phacoemulsification, as everyone knows. What they don't know is that Monday to Saturday, he would be doing 20 surgeries every morning and then seeing this huge OPD load by himself. And then Friday night, he would sit till 3 and 4 a.m. and make slides. And these were the old days. There was no computer and no PowerPoint. So you made slides the old-fashioned way by typing stuff on a screen, taking photographs, developing them yourself at night, and then taking the slide carousel with you and take a flight, go to some conference somewhere, operate live because that was what he did, and then come back Sunday late night, and then Monday morning the whole thing repeats itself. I remember going to school in the 3rd, 4th standard. He would drop me to school in his Fiat, and along with him was Mr. Appasamy, who had just made a irrigation aspiration unit. This was 1975. They would go to Kamatipura Municipal Hospital, and then he would be putting in the hard PMMA implants. And these were early days. People were not very happy. I remember him saying even then that the All India Society did not want to see any papers about implants. If you wrote anything about implants, they just threw it away and you never got a chance. So it's ironic that one day he became scientific chairman for 2 terms and president of the same society. But to bypass all these silly old regulations, and they started the Implant Society of India, of which he's been the president and one of the founding members. So till today in his conference, he always gives anyone a chance, somebody wants to say anything new, and there is no bias and stuff like that because he's faced it on his way up. So I would have to say the best moment for me along with him was when he got his Padma Shri from the President of India. So we went along to Delhi to Rashtrapati Bhavan, which I had never seen before from inside or outside. And it was one of the proudest moments of my life. And he's been a great father. I've learned everything from him, from how to hold the probe, how to make an incision, and everything that you see me doing today, I've probably learned from him, including LASIK. So all the best, Dad. You are really a living legend, and you are one of a kind.
That was really sweet, sir. It was really sweet, yeah.
Thanks,
sir. So regarding practice, I think probably at that point was the highest point in your career, right? What do you consider as your greatest achievement?
The fact that I could manage to start doing implants so early, I think was probably the maximum thing which we could have, because I personally think that maybe I helped push ophthalmology a little faster down the line.
Right.
Also did the same for phaco. I think I was about first one to really do phaco in regular practice. You know, in those early days when you put in a phaco, a little mistake in vitreous came out. And one of my pet sayings in those days was that the road to phaco is slippery with vitreous. Those two things really pushed it away. And then after that, of course, the only other thing which I can think of is that I was one of the earliest from India to present papers all over the world and won a lot of awards and all that. That is okay. But what I'm happy about is that I flew our flag high.
And yes, we are so proud of you, sir. Absolutely.
Accepted that we are mainstream, not just something to be left on the side. And now, of course, we got so many of us carrying the banner. It makes me very proud of all of them.
Great. So, and if you consider practice, compared to so many years ago, today practice is becoming increasingly difficult. Like, we are seeing so many vicissitudes in the form of changes in governance and laws and restrictions and COVID to top it all. Does all this bother you?
No, it doesn't bother me. It's I always have a simple concept. If you are faced with a brick wall, there's no point in butting your head against. You just find a way around it. So, I mean, it comes to the same thing here. You know, they have restrictions. But look at the bright side of it. the more the restrictions, the lesser the number will practice, the more will be your practice. Couldn't have it better.
Absolutely.
How it is. I mean, you never really crib ke ye kyun hua. The answer is, let's find a way out for it.
Right. So any message like you would like to give us mortals on how to deal with all these issues?
Nothing. Take it in your stride, have a big smile and have a laugh. Nothing happens. You know, people jo rote hote hain aur rote reh jate hain.
Kya baat hai sir.
Smile.
Two pearls of wisdom, absolutely.
Life is really good. I've had a great time. I've enjoyed myself.
Enjoy yourself. That's I think the crux of the entire thing, right?
Get ready to hang up. I'm still waiting for something more new to come.
Wow, that's the spirit. That's the spirit. Sir, you've been the man behind iAdvance, like for the last almost more than 25 years. There is someone who has been your contemporary and wants to give you a message today. Let's hear this.
Padma Shri Professor Dr. K.K. Mehta is known as K.K. amongst his friends. I have been associated with him for the last 44 years. I think he's a great clinician, excellent surgeon, and above all, a very good teacher. Few of us may be knowing that he's a good inventor and a research worker. His contribution for a soft implant in 1983 and his paper read in USA stunned number of ophthalmologists. Nobody ever thought about a soft or a foldable implant in 1983. He established his name in the annals of ophthalmology. He has been president of number of societies, BOA, Implant Society, AIOS, and a number of international societies. I have to not speak about his other contribution to various societies, but we are associated with him for last 25 years in iAdvance. In iAdvance, he is the principal man to organize the conference and looking after all aspects of conference. I don't think that there can be any iAdvance without Dr. K.K. Mehta. He's very kind-hearted, very generous, and a soft-hearted person. He's back in all his ophthalmological adventures and in his personal life by his little lady called Dr. Zenobia. He not only advises and look after his normal life, but also academically begin helping Keki to achieve the higher heights. I wish him all the success.
That was so sweet of him, sir, and so true.
You don't know, you know, the three of us who run iAdvance, Ranjit, Kirit, and myself, we are known as the three musketeers.
Musketeers, absolutely so true. And sir, as he said so rightly,
had wonderful times together.
Yes, sir. And as he so rightly said, behind every successful man is a woman. And we have seen Dr. Zenobia, ma'am, with you every time over the last so many years. How would you describe her role in your life?
Extraordinary. I mean, she was, as one would say, the rudder to my ship. Without her, I would be going haywire here and there because I go on conceiving new concepts all the time. She holds me to the road and makes sure I remain where it should be. But I mean, leaving aside everything, she's been a marvelous person. She is an incredible person with and has great thoughts. She knows exactly how to work about it. And I've been blessed actually with her and
three
wonderful children. So I mean, part of the fact that I can enjoy, laugh and enjoy life is that she's there behind me all the time, and she's still there now, so I'm happy that she's there, and I couldn't be happier for her. But you know, if you really want to have a great life, I think you need to have a great wife.
True. So, and I think you would love to listen to this. Let's see what she has to say about you.
He is the most wonderful husband, the best husband anyone could. He is the best and the most brilliant eye surgeon in the world, using the best and most advanced machines, lasers, techniques and technologies, with excellent, most outstanding and most superb operating skills.
Yes. That was simply adorable. Yeah. I must say, I think she was the lady luck smiling upon you, right?
I think lady luck has smiled on me is probably because she has been smiling on me also.
She has been smiling on you, absolutely. So talking of luck, if I were to ask you, say out of 100%, if you consider luck, hard work, passion and talent, summing it up to 100%, what would you think, or would you add anything else?
I think basically, I think more than 80% is just hard work. But leaving aside that, two things you require. One is you should be able to be prepared to take risks. And when you take risks, you have to be prepared also to have people turn around and tell you things which you don't want to hear, which you have to take on the way. If you're willing to do that, then you will progress forward. So the important thing is, you know, people ask me, I'm starting my career, what should I do? And I tell them, I asked them a very simple question. Why would a patient come to you? Have you got any new skills? Anybody know? Have you done something new?
Right.
Doing something more than the other person? And they said no. So I tell them, you, it can be a very small thing, but you should specialize in something in your field. So then people have a reason to come, and people will give you and will then follow you where you go.
Right. So,
I'm also a cataract surgeon, doesn't pay. It can be a little thing. It can be that I'm a master of soft implants, or I'm a master of soft cataracts. Could be anything. Could be something small, but you should have something to talk to your about. Because
yes,
when he talks to other patients, he will say, "Arey, he has this."
Right, but, right, absolutely.
And there are little things which, what I call as selling points. You know,
yes, USP.
Irrespective of how great a surgeon you are, maybe, until you can. Until the patient feels that.
Absolutely. Right, right. Absolutely.
I said, talk with your patient. Chat with him. He should feel, I have come to a good doctor. Then you progress.
Absolutely. So, like, you are one of the finest surgeons India has ever seen. So, what thoughts come to your mind when you are operating?
Nothing. Really. I don't know. It depends. The first thing, of course, is you want to be able to do an exceptional job, which is what you do. Once in a while, if you get in, the important thing is, before you do any surgery, especially if it's a difficult surgery, plan an exit strategy. You look at a hard cataract and you may drop it. So have your things ready if you drop it. Can you manage it at that time? And that is not the time to then say, "Kya mera vitrector kaam kar raha hai ya nahi kar raha hai," and things like that. So the important thing, I think, is to plan your exit strategy. If you do that, then life is always good. No matter how difficult the case, you will always manage. But you need to do that, work on it, and then in case your skills are not fully developed, develop your skills.
So how would you advise the upcoming surgeons who want to hone their surgical skills?
I would certainly advise them to go and visit places where top surgeons are there. You know, the funny thing about ophthalmology is there is no surgeon who will ever tell you, "Don't come and see me operate." But it's just that, you know, you always feel that, how can I go and sit and listen to him? I have gone personally and sat with surgeons all over the world. I've sat with surgeons in India. I've seen them operate. I've enjoyed with them. And, you know, you always learn something new from everyone. Let me put it this way, you know, ophthalmology is more like my hobby. I enjoy it.
So well said. So there is something someone remembers about you. Just a moment.
I'm Dr. Ashok Palviya. I had the privilege of working with Dr. Keki sir at Kamatipura Municipal Eye Hospital from 1982 to 1986. It was a real experience, wonderful experience I had with him. One thing about sir, even at those times, he was very, very forward thinking and he was very happy-go-lucky. He never used to fire his juniors ever. I've never seen him firing any of our juniors in Kamatipura that time. He used to always be ready to help his juniors whenever he could. I still remember that he had brought the RK knife and we were doing radiography for the first time at Kamatipura. And after doing two or three cases, I had told sir, okay, sir, I would like to do that as my thesis topic. Without a second thought, he gave me his knife and he told me, okay, you choose the cases, we will do it together. He was always forthcoming and never, he used to always help us in learning new things and all. And I still remember his favorite dialogue that he used to say, tell us, all the other sirs will teach you ophthalmology. I will teach you how to drive a Mercedes by the age of 40. He used to give us real practical tips on private practice. Sir, it was a real pleasure working under you, though I still haven't got my Mercedes till now. Thank you.
Yes. So how is a typical weekday in the life of Dr. Keki Mehta?
Well, now in the week, the usual was very simple. You operated in the morning, you saw patients in the afternoon, and you slept at night. But the important thing was, you know, until recently, until a few years back, the regular routine was that irrespective of how many hours you worked or how late you slept, you always spent at least an hour or hour and a half reading manuals, reading journals. Because unless you keep yourself abreast, life will pass you by and it passes you by very quickly.
This is such calls of wisdom, sir.
Customarily, you know, I used to work from Monday to Friday, and on Saturday, Sundays, I was always in some city or the other lecturing, talking or operating. That hadn't been my routine for many, many years. But now that the routine has changed, but I spend at least half the day on Saturday reading, seeing new things that come up. Because, you know, you need to know what the world is doing. You can't just live in a vacuum. You need to read. And I think the worst thing which tends to happen is when a surgeon feels that, I don't need to do this anymore. Then he loses touch and then he is no longer what he is. He then, instead of being a surgeon, he becomes a dukandar. Then, you know, he danda kar rahe. It's not the doctor, mommy, it's fun here, enjoy it.
Such words of wisdom, sir. I really, hats off to you. So what gives you a bigger kick? Is it loads of work or anything else? Like you say, enjoy your work. Anything else that gives you a better kick or bigger kick than ophthal?
Enjoy having a big kick. Enjoy a long list. Sure, that's fine. I mean, but what gives me more pleasure is if I've done a difficult case and the result comes out good. More so if the patient has been refused surgery by others. I've always put my foot in where others have not. Sometimes I wonder whether, and I've managed to get away up to now without having any case against my name. But you know, this is something you have to be careful nowadays. In the olden days was different. You know, you could take up very difficult cases.
And that's your skill. That's your skill.
The pleasure comes, you know, when you have a difficult case, you do it well, the result is good. The patient is smiling and you say, this patient ke liye tha, the fact that I am in this world made a difference. That is what it matters.
You've tasted so much success. So how do you deal with success? I mean, how do you handle success? What's it like to be the Dr. Keki Mehta?
I've never really taken success as a measure. I'm what I am. I enjoy life. If people think I've done and I've been successful, thank you for it. But I've never chased.
To be humble in success, you know, in Sanskrit there is a saying which says, "Namanti palino vrukshah, namanti gunino janah," which means a tree which is laden with ripe, juicy fruit bends down, and so also as a person becomes more accomplished, like you, and he becomes more humble. And I think you are a perfect example of it. So as we are talking on this, let's hear what someone has to say about you. Just a moment.
Actually, it was iAdvance where we really formed up the mentor-mentee relationship, he being the mentor, obviously. I take you back to 1994 and I'll tell you about how he delegates work. There was to be an early morning conference, breakfast course at 8 o'clock, and the doors were locked at Baidas. He didn't interfere when I broke the lock. We just paid for the lock and that's it. That was the level of delegation. Right through iAdvance, AIOC and every conference that we've had, he would say, Ranjit, get this done, and that's it. This was done. There was never any interference. We loved it. We really are a great team. Actually, Keki has contacts on both sides of the political divide. And not just politics. I tell you one instance where we were at the sales tax office for one of the iAdvance issues. And when he gave his card to the commissioner of sales tax, the man actually got up from his seat, came and sat down on this side of the table and said, Sir, you are a Padma Shri, you are Dr. Keki Mehta, you please sit here in my chair. I can't be interviewing you, you have to sit in my chair. That is the level of respect that he commands, not just from politicians, but ordinary bureaucrats too.
Wow, that's really fascinating.
But I tell you, leaving that aside, I tell you about Ranjit. He is a great organizer, one of the best organizers I've seen in the world. An exceptional person, and nothing phases him. You know, long before we had a working relationship, I used to tell him, we need to do it. And it used to be done.
Wow. You were a great team.
With Kirit and Ranjit and I, we did great conferences. And next year, we're looking forward to do a large virtual conference. Let's see how it turns out.
Right. So that question comes to... that brings a question to my mind. Like, suppose you were given a second chance, a chance to live your life all over again and do it all over again, would you have done anything differently?
Oh, not really. I think I still would have done a lot of what I would have done, but perhaps I would have done it with a little better style, as one would say. Maybe I would not have left so many people unhappy. Because, you know, I used to just go ahead and do things which I thought needed to be done. And in those days at All India, I used to turn around and argue non-stop. Because this is not the way, and this is how it should be. And people used to say, okay, yeah, dude, give us a little bit of latitude. What I thought was right, and I've always said so. But then I've been blessed with great friends, not only Kirit, Ranjit, and the others, and Dr. Lahane, who's been a very good friend of mine, but people like Professor Sachdev Mahipal and Amar Agarwal, who are one of my closest friends. And with their support, you know, when you have good friends, life is great. The support
is great. Absolutely, sir. And like we are so amazed by the kind of enthusiasm you have and the drive that you have. So what keeps you going, sir?
There's always a good hope. I haven't, as I said, hanging up my gloves yet. Wait. People ask me, dear, at your age, abhi aur kya kar raha hai? Main kaha, abhi gaadi shuru hui hai, band nahi hui
hai. Kya baat hai, sir? Kya baat hai? So that also brings me to the point of what do you think is the ideal work-life balance? And 1 minute, before you even answer this question, I'm sure you would love to hear this. Just a moment.
Hi, I'm Shirina. I'm Dr. Keki Mehta's daughter. I'd like to tell you a little bit about myself. I've got 2 kids and I run a background screening company. And of course, the man of the hour, my dad. I would love to introduce him. It's been my honor to be asked to do the same. He has been a very good father and a very indulgent father to all of us. When I go back to my earliest memories of him being a child and running in and out of his clinic, he was always available, always there, even though he was tirelessly working from early in the morning to late hours into the night. I remember coming home from school and running into the clinic and chatting up with him every evening. There was never a time that he would turn us away for anything. His work ethic has been something that's inspired us all. since I've been a very young girl, I've seen him work tirelessly and hard through all hours of the day and night. And that showed me that from a very young age, success in life comes to those who work for it. As I see my father today, all these years later, he is yet working tirelessly. His fervor hasn't diminished. He is always there to give a helping hand to so many people who come across and along the way. The one thing I would love to teach my children is how you can not only be a legend in your own field, but also be the most charitable and generous person I know. I hope one day to take up the mantle of being able to do all the good that he has done all through his life. And a message to my dad. Dad, we love you and admire you. And I hope you continue to be our 911 call and let us harass you at all hours of the day and night with all our worries and woes and take care of us. Love you lots.
My father's a lovely person. He's very caring. He's very sweet. And any silly small problem I have, I always go to him and he's always there to help me. He never says no. He always makes sure I'm fine. And I'm just really lucky to have such a sweet, caring father who's so intelligent and such an inspiration and an icon. Love you, Daddy.
That was so sweet, sir. Now, please tell me, sir, what's your side of the story and how did you manage to achieve it?
I don't know. I mean, I've just been blessed by having wonderful, wonderful children. Now, Cyrus, who couldn't ask for a better son, a brilliant surgeon, and I'm happy I could be a part of his life ahead. And Shin has a fabulous daughter. She now runs a major agency, and I'm impressed actually how she can manage it. But she does it extremely well. And my youngest son, of course, is now one of the top photographers in the world with pictures in some of the foremost magazines like Vogue, etc. But it is lovely to hear your children praising you.
Must feel good, right? So now coming to how do you unwind? Like, what does Dr. K.K. Mehta do on a lazy Sunday afternoon? Apart from, like you said, a lot of reading on Saturdays?
I don't know. Walk around, move around, sit with the children. You see, the whole thing is you need to stretch your imagination a little. I also am in Rotary, and I'm in Rotary not that I can spare the time, but they are a totally different group. So you need to always move with different groups, and you need to move with your children more because you know they look at life differently. Their friends are different. I try to be with their friends as much as possible, and you know you get a different viewpoint of the world. It relaxes you. Technology is. Can tend to get a little boring sometimes. Spread out a little.
Talking of friends, let's see what your friend about you.
Besides ophthalmology, Keki has varied interests. He reads a lot. He loves music. I remember there was a time when I was sourcing the Blue Danube by Johann Strauss. It was for one of my movies. And he says, "Oh, you want that? Here it is." He picks it up from his library, gives it to me and says, "Here, keep it, it's yours." That was his generosity. So Keki is a big-hearted, kind, gentle soul with deep pockets. He always picks up the check. But he also attacks the food first. He's been a friend, a philosopher, a counselor, and a lovely guide. His favorite advice to me, and you know, I really get carried away, but his favorite advice to me is, "Hey man, mungo mardi, em karish te karwa deni, tane su andosh."
That was really sweet.
And I've spent wonderful times together.
Yes, yes.
Ask for a better friend. It's actually more like a brother, really.
Yeah, it feels so fulfilling, right? So one last question before we go on to the rapid fire round. So, say 10 years down the line, where do you expect ophthalmology and its innovations to be?
See, ophthalmology is now becoming more and more, as one would say, science-driven or instrument-driven. And I think artificial intelligence is going to come in a big way. There's going to be significant changes, and I no longer think it's going to be a single person group. You'll be now working with a neurologist or a neurosurgeon, because the connections onto the brain will soon going to come. I don't believe after a period of another 5 years, people will remain blind. They will be getting vision. And the one of the ways in doing that essentially is something which we somehow have not reached yet, and that is to have cortical connections with an external camera. But that is where it lies. And I think these changes are soon going to come. So I think we are now going to look forward to something really interesting in the next few decades. And one of the reasons why I'm still round and kicking is because I don't want to miss the fun which is going to come in the next few years. Because I believe ophthalmology is really going to go up. But you do need two, three things you need to do if you really want to have the wave or attack the wave. You need to have a sound basic knowledge of mathematics, and you should be able to do good statistics. And the most important thing is you should be able to read and get out new concepts which you can apply in your own life. Because that is what makes life interesting. That is what has made my life interesting. It's never been boring. That much I can say.
Yeah, true pearls of wisdom, sir. Thank you so much for it. So now, sir, we will move on to our rapid fire round. So okay. In which there would be questions in rapid succession. And I would request you, sir, to quickly answer whatever thought first comes to your mind, however wild it may be. So shall we start?
Our insight.
So what gives you goosebumps?
You give me goosebumps? The risks which tend to occasionally occur when a lens is about to drop inside the eye. That's the time you really start feeling that, oh boy, you're in trouble.
In one word, describe Mumbai.
A fabulous city. It will accommodate whatever you do and will always support you. I really could not have succeeded in any other city. I'm happy to go in Mumbai.
So one person with whom you would like to exchange places with?
I think Amar Agarwal. He has done things that are again extraordinary, and he's done it with Elan. I think it would have been fun to change places with him. But I wonder how he managed in my place. Still, it would have been fun.
If you have 1 hour to spend with any personality, past or present, who would it be?
1 hour?
1 hour.
1 hour. Well, in that case, I personally would have spent it with Peter Fison, who is a person I originally worked with. He was the first person I got in touch with when I was in London. And he's a brilliant man. Really not given the laudatory work which he really deserves. But he was an exceptional man. And you know, the funny thing is, if I can say a little in the middle.
Yeah, sure.
Abhay Vasavada, Amar Agarwal and myself are all three retina people who have gone into cataracts. Maybe the reason why we manage so easily is that the fear of the back of the eye, the unknown, is not there.
Right. How nice, yes. So for the last so many years now, we have known Dr. K.K. Mehta, the ophthalmologist. Please describe Dr. K.K. Mehta, the person, in 3 words.
He enjoyed life.
Wow, that's great. Okay. First thing that comes to your mind when I say the following. Marriage.
Exceptional, enjoying, wonderful. I've had the best of it. I could not have asked for more.
Great. Competition.
Always good. Competition is what spurs you on. And having competition is what makes a person improve.
That's the positivity in you.
Great. It makes life great.
Great. Money.
I've had enough. I could have asked for more, but I mean, you know, there's never enough as one would go. Of course, nowadays COVID has come, so the money has gone.
What's the best compliment you've ever received?
Best compliment? I think you've done a great job, which they usually turn around and say at the end of a good surgery. And you know, you feel that, yeah, acha hai, kuch to bol rahe.
So that's your modesty. What is the one thing you would like people to remember about you?
There was a man who did good work. He lived a good life. He enjoyed himself. And he left something for the world to follow.
With due respect, sir, what's your biggest weakness?
I tend to go into territories where I should not. I should be more careful, think along and do, but that has never been me. Me is the guy who just goes in where it is, does what he wishes to do, and I get roughed up once in a while, but that's part of the game.
One thing the world doesn't know about you.
That I play music. That I play.
Wow.
Play a harmonica. I play a guitar. I play a mandolin.
Oh my God.
What should I call it? And I'm fond of instruments. My father was very fond of instruments. So, but I don't turn around and tell everybody because they turn around and say, play it here and play it there.
Wow, that's really.
Actually, I'm good in any of them, but I enjoy it.
Nice to know, sir. Really nice to know. One thing you wish you could change about yourself, I know you already mentioned it, but anything else?
Change about myself? Well, I wish I could have been born maybe another 15 or 20 years earlier, because there were a number of new things in those days which I missed out on. You know, the development of the erysipelago, for example, were things were there earlier. And I think I came on the scene just a little too late.
Something that you enjoy doing and wish you had more time for?
Music. But that is unfortunately has to take the side handle. I have all the instruments. I rarely get the opportunity to play them. And abhi nahi karenge, kal karenge, parso karenge. And after some time, you tend to get rusty and then the fingers don't start to flow. And you know, you get irritable when the fingers don't do what you want them to do.
I really hope you really get to do what you want, sir. Really nice. And today we have known such different facets of your personality, sir. Really, you're truly a role model for all of us. So before we sign off, is there any message that you would want to give to all us ophthalmologists who look up to you?
A great do it with Ilan. Do what you wish to do. Don't listen to people. And most important of all, have a nice time and enjoy it. Because the saddest part is, you know, when you see people walking around with a long face, they should not. They should be smiling. They should feel, as I said earlier, that I've had a great innings. More is yet to come.
Great, sir. Great, sir. That was absolutely amazing. So it was such a pleasure talking to you. And I've enjoyed every moment of what we have interacted today. And thank you so much for sparing your valuable time and sharing such lovely pieces and parts of your life with us. So I'd also like to thank all those who gave their videos to us, Dr. Kirit Modi sir, Dr. Ranjit Manyar sir, especially for all the efforts he has put in, Zenobia ma'am, Dr. Ashok Palya sir, Dr. Cyrus Mehta, Shirina, Rustam, everyone. I'd also like to thank FTC Pixel for the support and my IT team from Anilai Hospital for helping me put all of this together. So we wish you very, very good health, lots of happiness, and best wishes to you and your family, sir.
Thank you very much.
And I've learned a lot today from what we have interacted, and I'm sure all the viewers would enjoy it as immensely as I have done today. And these are really, truly treasured moments and as sweet as the memories that I've had of you in the past. And I would like to share with you. Thank you so much from the bottom of my heart, and this is what I wanted to share with you. This was a picture that we had taken when we were both on stage during MoSCON 2018, and I really cherish all those moments. And after listening to your wonderful and inspiring life stories, all I can say is greatness is not just a destination, it's a continuous journey that never ends, and your life has been a perfect example of this. All I can say is Jina isi ka naam hai. Thank you once again, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you.